So under trigonometric equation, we have to start solving certain miscellaneous type of trigonometric equation. Okay, so I call them as miscellaneous equations. Okay, the first equation that we are going to talk today is an equation which involves almost all trigonometric functions, the basic standard trigonometric function, sine, cos, tan, sec, cosec, cot, etc. So equations involving such kind of functions, how do we solve these kind of questions? See, up till now, the type of equations that we were solving, in those equations, there was only one trigonometric function involved. Or if at all there was, let's say, two trigonometric function involved, then one could be written in terms of the other. Like if you remember, there was a question involving sine square theta and cos theta. So we could write sine square in terms of cos. And if at all we had, let's say, both sine and cos, which were not interconvertible into each other, then we used the harmonic form to convert them as a single trigonometric function. If you recall, there was a form that we did, a sine x plus b cos x equal to c. So that was a form where we converted it to a harmonic form. Okay. Now here in this case, you'll realize that you have multiple trigonometric functions involved. How to solve those kind of functions? Let's begin with a question. Okay, let's say this question. Okay. As you can see in this question, first read this question, you have cos x minus sine x times 2 tan x plus 1 by cos x plus 2 equal to 0. So all the type of functions are involved here, sine, cos, tan, okay. So now how do I solve such kind of question? What is the standard operating procedure for solving such kind of a problem? So for such kind of a problem, we basically use the half angle formula in terms of tan, because all the trigonometric functions, whether it is sine, whether it is cos, whether it is tan, or even their reciprocals, they can all be written in terms of half angles of tan. For example, sine x could be written as 2 tan x by 2 by 1 plus tan square x by 2. Correct? Cos x could be written as 1 minus tan square x by 2 by 1 plus tan square x by 2. And of course, tan x itself can be written as 2 tan x by 2 by 1 minus tan square x by 2. So what is the advantage here? The advantage here is that instead of dealing with diversified kind of trigonometric equation, you are converting it to a single type of trigonometric equation, which is tan x by 2. So using a single trigonometric ratio to express this entire left-hand side. So when you express the entire left-hand side in terms of a single trigonometric ratio, which in this case is tan, then you can easily take that as a t. For example, I can take tan x by 2 as a t. So this entire expression will get converted to a polynomial kind of an equation. And polynomial kind of an equation is easy for us to solve. Okay. So let us try to apply this procedure onto this question. And let's see how effective it becomes in solving the problem. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to call tan x by 2 as a t. Okay. I'm going to call tan x by 2 as a t. So this will become 2t by 1 plus t square. This will become 1 minus t square by 1 plus t square. This will become 2t by 1 minus t square. Correct? So if I substitute it over here, let's see, what do I get? Let me put a barricade over here. Yeah. So cos x will become 1 minus t square by 1 plus t square. Sin x will become 2t by 1 plus t square. 2 tan x will become 2 into 2t by 1 minus t square. And reciprocal of cos will become 1 plus t square by 1 minus t square plus 2 equal to 0. Fine? Plus 2 equal to 0. Now, let's try to simplify it further. So, numerator here will become t square plus 4t plus 1. And denominator will be 1 plus t square, 1 minus t square, which is nothing but 1 minus t to the power 4. Okay, plus 2 equal to 0. Right? Let's multiply throughout with 1 minus t to the power 4. By the way, let me write it like this. Yeah. Let's multiply throughout with 1 minus t to the power 4. So this boils down to this equation. Okay. Now let's simplify. So here you have a t square. Here you have a minus, t to the power 4. Here you have minus 2t to the power 4. So that will become minus 3t to the power 4. Correct? So see, minus t to the power 4 from here and minus 2t to the power 4. So that will make it as minus 3t to the power 4. Next, t cube coefficient will come from here, minus 2t cube and minus 4t cube. So that will become minus 6t cube. T square will be minus t square plus t square and minus 8t square. So that will become minus 8t square. Okay. And t will be 4t minus 2t, which is going to be plus 2t. And constant terms would be 1 plus 2, which is 3. Is it fine? Now you must be thinking, ayyo sir, you ended up getting a biquadratic equation. How are we going to solve a biquadratic equation? Because we have only learned how to solve quadratic equations. Okay, so don't worry. Whenever you have any polynomial equation, I mean, whose degree is more than 2, we have to guess one of the roots. Okay. However, there are methods to solve cubic and biquadratic equations also directly by using some, you can say higher level concepts called the Cardan's method and the Ferrari's method and the Descartes method and all. But of course, right now we are not going to go into those concepts. So now we have to guess one of the roots here, at least one of the roots we have to start with, correct? Now, if you have taken your tan x by 2, now this is some, gyan which I'm giving you. So tan x by 2 is taken as a t, right? Now think of some values which tan can give you. So normally tan is known to give, values like 1, minus 1, however it can give any real values, but the ones which are commonly seen, okay? So if you talk about 0 degree, 30 degree, 45 degree, 60 degree, etc., the values which are commonly seen is something like 1, minus 1, 1 by root 3, minus 1 by root 3, root 3, minus root 3, etc. Okay, so first try out such substitutions. Now, this is not with surety that one of the substitution will definitely work. Okay, this is just a, you can say, smart guess, which I'm doing. It may fail. Okay, I'm not trying to say that these substitutions will definitely work fine. Okay, so since tan has been substituted as t, we will try with those values which are commonly seen in the ratio of tan, like 1 minus 1, root 3, negative root 3, 1 by root 3, negative 1 by root 3. Now, it may not work also, but that is the only option that we can try with. Okay. Now, does 1 work? I don't think so, because the sum of the coefficient should become 0 if 1 has to work. Okay. So, 1 is not going to work. Correct. So, this is not going to work. Is minus 1 going to work? No. For minus 1 to work, the sum of the even powers coefficient should add up to give you the sum of the odd powers coefficient. That means minus 11 plus 3, which is minus 8, should be equal to minus 4, which we know is not correct. So even this will not work. Try 1 by root 3. Does it work? Let's check 1 by root 3. So 1 by root 3, this will give me minus 3, 1 by 3 square. Minus 6 by 3 root 3, minus 8 by 3 plus 2 by root 3 plus 3. Does it become a 0? Let's check. This is minus 1 by 3, minus 2 by root 3, minus 8 by 3 plus 2 by root 3 plus 3. I think this gets cancelled. And minus 9 by 3, which is 3. Oh yes, it gets cancelled, gives you 0. So this is working fine. This is working fine. Yes or no? Okay. So this is working fine. Try with negative 1 by root 3. Negative 1 by root 3 will also give you minus 1 by 3 plus 6 by 3 root 3, which is this, minus 8 by 3 minus 2 by root 3 plus 3. Does it work? Oh yes, minus 9 by 3 plus 3, that gives you a 0. So this also works, okay? Now, two of the roots out of 4 we have already guessed, okay? Root 3, will it work? Check it out. Root 3, will it work? Minus 3, root 3 to the power 4 will be 3 square. Minus 6 into 3 root 3. Minus 8 into 3 plus 2 root 3 plus 3. 18 root 3, 24. No, this is not going to work. Okay. And I don't think so. Minus root 3 will also work. So these two are not going to work. Okay. But nevertheless, I think it's a great help that I have got two of the roots. What if it doesn't work? Then it's a difficult question to solve, because you know, solving a biquadratic equation is not something that is very easy. Okay, but such a situation will be very rare, so as to say, because the question setter knows that the question that he or she has to provide must be solvable, right? Of course, he can give you weird values to solve, but that's not how the questions are designed. Just to tell you, when questions are designed, the question setters themselves sit and solve it. Okay. Just to talk about your school exams. Okay. Your school teacher first herself will solve the question paper. Do you know that? No. She has to prepare a marking scheme or the answer for that question paper. Okay. That is required by the school management. So let's say I set a question paper, I'll sit and solve it. So these, all the testing agencies, whether you talk about NTA or, you know, NEET people, they will solve the question paper. And when they realize that, no, this is something which the child will not be able to complete within 2 to 3 minutes, they will automatically remove the question. Okay. Trust me, this happens. They don't give arbit numbers. They don't give arbit figures. Okay. Because they will be challenged in the court of law. They will say, okay, solve this question in 4 minutes. You are expecting people to solve it in 4 minutes. You solve it in 4 minutes. If they themselves don't solve it, they cannot ask that question. Okay. All right. Now, anyway, so we have got two of the roots. So we have to find the remaining four roots. Now, all of you, please pay attention. The equation which was given to you has t equal to 1 by root 3 and t equal to minus 1 by root 3 as two of the roots. Okay. So can I say root 3 t minus 1 and root 3 t plus 1, they will be two of the factors. So can I say these are factors of the left-hand side expression? So what was that left-hand side expression? Okay, this expression, by the way, you can drop the factor of minus also. You can just write 3t to the power 4 plus 6t cube plus 8t square minus 2t minus 3. So this expression that you have, which I'm showing with the curly braces, that equation has got two of its factors as root 3 t plus 1 and root 3 t minus 1. Okay. So in short, 3t to the power 4 plus, if I'm not mistaken, it was 6t cube, 8t square minus 2t minus 3. This can be factorizable as, see, what is the product of these two? 3t square minus 1. Okay. And some quadratic will come over here. Okay. So this question mark will be some quadratic. Why? Because total number of roots are 4. 2 you have already found out. So 2 more are supposed to be found out, which can be hidden in a quadratic expression. Okay. So how do I find this quadratic expression? I have a simple technique here. And that technique is also known to most of you. There is a 3t to the power 4 sitting here, and you already have 3t square. So you can have a t square over here so that the product becomes 3t to the power 4. Okay. You already have a minus 3 here. You have a minus 3 here, and you already have minus 1. So there will be a plus 3 here. Correct? Now, the only thing which is not going to be, easily seen is your coefficient of t. So you can assume it to be some kt. So what I'm doing, I'm trying to factorize this without actually using the long division method. Okay. So I'm trying to factorize this without using a long division method. So what I'm going to do here is, I'm just going to compare coefficient of, let's say, t cube or t square or t, any of the thing you can basically choose. Let's compare the coefficient of t cube from both the sides. Okay. T cube from both the sides. So left side coefficient of t cube is 6. Our right side t cube coefficient will come from 3k. That's it. I don't think so. Any other term will contribute a t cube. So k becomes a 2. That means this expression is nothing but 3t square minus 1 into t square plus 2t plus 3. Okay. Now, what we are trying to solve here, you are trying to solve a biquadratic polynomial equation. So instead of putting this as 0, you can afford to put this expression as a 0. Correct. Now, remember, this guy cannot be 0. Why? Why this guy cannot be 0? Why? Tell me. Write down on the chat box. Why this fellow cannot be 0? Tell me. So t square plus 2t plus 3 can be t plus 1 the whole square plus 1. Right? So this cannot be 0. So only possibility is 3t square is equal to 1. So t is equal to plus minus root 3. That's the only possibility. Yes or no? Correct? Now, so your tan square x by 2 is 1 by root 3 the whole square, isn't it? Because t is nothing but tan x by 2. So basically, I've squared both of them, which is as good as saying tan pi by 6 the whole square. So what is the general solution for such kind of equation? X by 2 is n pi plus minus pi by 6. Yes or no? Which means x is 2n pi plus minus pi by 3. That's your answer. Acha, Setu, do you explain yourself while solving a question in the exam? You say, okay, Setu, understand this is the way to solve it. Do you say all these things? Do you do all the steps which I'm showing you? No, right? So I am explaining you how to do the problem. That is why it is taking so much time. If I have to do the problem, see what are the steps I'll be writing? I'll be directly writing these steps. Okay, so these are the only steps which I'll be writing. Okay, so this question can be done in 4 minutes, maximum 5 minutes, not more than that. Fine. Does everybody remember all the basic formula that we had done in the last class? If not, please refer to your notes. I hope everybody remembers how to solve tan square variable equal to tan square some angle. Right? I hope you remember this. Does everybody remember this or not? Yes, no, maybe. Okay, great. Is it fine? Any questions here? So again, repeat the process. The process is, if you realize that there is a trigonometric equation given to you, where the trigonometric equation involves different types of trigonometric ratios, which are not readily intra-convertible. So that means you cannot make a single, you know, trigonometric ratio equation, like what we did in one of the questions before. We converted it to a quadratic in cos, right? Or we cannot write it as a single harmonic form, right? So in such cases, you can go with such methods. So this is one of the weapons in your armory. You can use it if there is a need like that. Fine. Is it okay? All right. So now we will move on to different types of, you know, another type I'm going to talk about. So second type that we are going to talk about are functions which involve something of this nature. That means there are equations which involve sine x plus cos x or sine x minus cos x along with sine x cos x. Okay. So here also one of the substitutions is going to help you out. But before that, I'll give you the question itself where such a thing is required. So let me just take a small question. Yeah. Let's say this question. Now, first of all, you apply your mind. If you were given this question, from the knowledge that you already had, how will you solve this question? please note there is no sine square and cos square here. Okay. So, okay. So if you are thinking that I'll divide by cos square and I'll start getting a quadratic in tan, that is not going to happen. Okay. This is a single sine, sine x term, single cos x terms. And this is a product of sine x cos x. Okay. So now here, what is the approach? All of you, please listen to me. Okay. So what do we do here? We take sine x plus cos x term to be t. So our effort is to convert it to a polynomial kind of an equation. So I will take sine x plus cos x to be a t. Now, what is the benefit of this? See, if you square both the sides, the square of it will be sine square x plus cos square x, okay, plus 2 sine x cos x, yes or no? Which is nothing like but saying that 1 plus 2 sine x cos x is t square. Correct? Which means your sine x cos x term could also be written in terms of t only. Right? So not only this term is substituted, even this term has got substituted in terms of t. So converting the equation in a single variable is always appreciated, is always favorable for us, because it normally gets converted to a single variable, maybe a polynomial equation, and we can always solve it. So in light of this, whatever I have done, I can write the expression as, so this expression could be written as t. Now see, this term is minus 2 root 2, and this term t square minus 1 by 2 equal to 0. In other words, you have got t minus root 2 t square minus 1 equal to 0. Correct. Let's try to simplify this. You can write this as root 2 t square minus t minus root 2 equal to 0. Correct? Yeah. Is it factorizable? Yes. Minus 2 t plus t. Okay. So take root 2 t common. So it's t minus root 2. Take 1 common, t minus root 2. So this will become root 2 t plus 1 times t minus root 2. Okay. Is it fine? So from here, two values of t come out. One is t is minus half. And other is t is root 2. Okay. Let's try to solve it now. By the way, any questions, any concerns so far? Now, many people ask me, sir, why did you give a minus here? Will it work for minus? Yes, why not? Even if you have sine x minus cos x, and if you square it, you can still obtain sine x into cos x term from there also. Okay. So it doesn't matter whether it is sine x plus cos x or sine x minus cos x. Take it as a t. Both will help you to get sine x into cos x expression in terms of t only. Okay. So there's nothing to worry, even if there is a sine x minus cos x in the expression. Okay. So now the question is just half solved. So your t was nothing but sine x plus cos x, and we have to solve. Okay, I'm so sorry. This is root 2. Yeah, we have to solve this equation, and here I have to solve this equation. Okay, now I will request you all to work this out and tell me what is the general solution that you're getting for this, and what is the general solution that you're getting for this. Okay, let me call this as A, and let me call this as B. So let's solve A first. Everybody, work on A. We have already done such questions in the last class. 10 first one. Okay, so what do we do in this case is we basically converted it to a harmonic form, right? If you all recall, it was the harmonic form. Okay, I don't want to repeat the process. So cos of x minus pi by 4 is nothing but minus half. Minus half is cos 2 pi by 3, correct? So the general solution that will come over here is x minus pi by 4 is 2n pi plus minus 2 pi by 3, correct? In other words, your x is nothing but 2n pi plus minus 2 pi by 3 plus pi by 4. Okay. Now, again, this is not a very, you know, correct way to write it. So you have to break this up. So it will be breaking up as 2n pi plus 2 pi by 3 plus pi by 4 and 2n pi minus 2 pi by 3 plus pi by 4. Okay. Let's check how much does it give you. This will give you, if I'm not mistaken, 2n pi plus 11 pi by 12. And this will give you 2n pi minus 5 pi by 12. Correct? Second one. Achha, by the way, second one, everybody would realize that this is an extreme value scenario. Okay? So this will happen. Okay, let me just write it down. So... yeah, so this will happen when cos x minus pi by 4 is equal to a 1, which is actually cos 0. Okay, so x minus pi by 4 is 2n pi. So x is 2n pi plus pi by 4. N belonging to integer. So three solutions will come up from here. One is this. Another one is this. And the third one is this. So three solutions for this equation. Of course, n belonging to integer. Please do not forget writing this. Right? Is this okay? So I would consider this to be a typical JEE advanced type of questions. So you may not get such kind of questions in JEE main exam, right? But be prepared for such scenarios. We cannot blindly say that it's not going to come ever in such exams. But yes, it is of a slightly higher, thinking order. So may not be asked in CET or JEE main. JEE main it may be. I mean, I'm not very sure, but not in regional entrance exams at least. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Yes, Shardul, do you have some questions? Your mic was on, that's why I said. Yeah, Shardul, any questions? Okay. All right. So I think we have covered a lot of aspects under equations. So time has now come that we move to trigonometric inequalities. Okay, let's try to move to trigonometric inequalities. Oh, two Shardulis have come into picture. Just a second. All right, so we are now going to talk about trigonometric inequalities. Trigonometric inequalities. So up till now, we were talking about the different types of trigonometric equations and the procedures, the standing operating procedures that we use to solve those type of equations. Now we are going to use more or less the similar strategy for solving trigonometric inequalities. Now, is there any standard way to solve trigonometric inequations? Yes, there is a standard way to solve trigonometric inequations also. See, what do we do first? We try to analyze a trigonometric equation inequation in a very small interval, let's say 0 to 2 pi. Or many times we prefer minus pi to pi also. That depends on question to question. I cannot generalize that. So what do? We first try to solve a trigonometric inequation in a smaller interval, like 0 to 2 pi or minus pi to pi. That depends upon the situation. Then what do? The upper and the lower limits of that interval, whatever we obtain as our answer for that small gap or small interval of 0 to 2 pi, we add n times the periodicity of that trigonometric function involved. Now, it's better to demonstrate it rather than talking about it. Let me demonstrate this with a simple example. Let's say I have sine x greater than or equal to half. Okay, let's say I want to solve this equation. Okay. Let's say I want to solve this equation using my graph. So when you're solving this equation, inequation by using a graph, what does it actually mean? You're trying to see. So this is equivalent to trying to say, when is the graph of sine x function above the graph of the straight line y equal to half? So for what values of x is the graph of sine x lying above the line y equal to half? Okay. Now, if you just draw the graph of sine x, okay, this is a sinusoidal function. Okay. It goes on and on, on and on. So no need to worry about a lot of values. Okay. And let's say this is your line, the blue line which I'm making is y equal to half line. Okay. This is y equal to half line. Fine. So this is sine x and this is y equal to half. Now I want to know all those intervals where your sine x graph is above y equal to half. Right? So what we are going to do is we first going to analyze that function in a very small interval, let's say 0 to 2 pi. Okay. So let us work on 0 to 2 pi. So in 0 to 2 pi, tell me, what are the values or what is the interval of x for which the function sine x is above y equal to half? So you'll say, sir, simple, it is in this zone, correct? In this zone, if you see, I'm just bubbling it up, okay? In this zone, if you see, your sine x graph is above y equal to half line or equal to y equal to half line, correct? So this is pi by 6 and this is 5 pi by 6, correct? If I'm not mistaken. So in that small interval, the answer or the solution for this inequation will be somewhere which is between 5 by 6 to half, 5 pi by 6. Yes or no? Yes or no? Correct. But is this the only possible answer? You'll say, no, sir, there will be so many other intervals, right? It could be this branch also, right? It could be this branch also. And there is no, there's no limit because this both the graphs are going to extend from minus infinity to infinity, right? Okay. So how do we tackle or how do we, take into account all those intervals? So this is what do? So what do is we just add, okay, now tell me what is the periodicity of sine x? What is the periodicity of sine x? Tell me. Write down on the chat box. Write down, everybody. Two pi. Yes or no? Right? So what do? We add 2n pi to both the upper and the lower limit. Okay. See, this is like, telling the examiner that the same interval at a gap of 2 pi will start, giving you the solution, isn't it? So we say union of all these values of x, okay, for n belonging to integer, this will be your answer to this inequation. So this u is basically union of all these intervals for n belonging to integer, that will become your final answer. Why union? Because even this is your answer, this is your answer, this is your answer. So you have to take a union of all those intervals. So your intervals are like sets, isn't it? Right? So if you take a union of all those answers and start writing it. Is it fine? Any questions? Any concerns? Okay. All right. Let's try one more. Can you take one more? All right. Let's take cos x greater than, let's say, minus half. Okay. Now, this time I would request you to try this out. I'm giving 1 minute to everybody to try this out. Yes. Should we check this out? Okay. So let us make the graph of cos x first. Okay. So this is your graph of cos x. I hope everybody knows cos x graph. This is your cos x graph. Okay. Now, this question is as good as asking for which values of x is cos x graph higher than y equal to minus half graph. So y equal to minus half graph is something like this. Okay. This is y equal to minus half. Fine. Now, all of you please pay attention. So in this case, what I will do, as I told you, I can analyze the function either between 0 to 2 pi or between minus pi to pi. That depends on the situation. So in this present situation, I am going to analyze the function between minus pi to pi. Okay. So between minus pi to pi, what is the interval for which your graph is, or your cos x graph is higher than y equal to minus half? So you'll say, sir, this is the part where your cos x graph is higher than y equal to minus half. So this interval is minus 2 pi by 3, isn't it? So this, for minus pi to pi, this is the answer that you are getting. Now, why do I always choose minus pi to pi? Why do I always choose minus pi to pi? Because you want to account for one complete 2 pi interval. Are you getting my point? Yes or no? Okay. So once I have got this, I can now generalize it. So I can now generalize it by adding the periodicity of cost function. So you have to write 2n pi. Just add it to the upper and the lower limit like this. Okay. And take a union of all these answers for all n belonging to integers. So this is the x interval in which, you know, your function, your x should lie, the variable should lie for this inequality to be satisfied. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns, anybody? See, if you take 0 to 2 pi, what will happen is, if you take 0 to 2 pi, then 2 pi basically starts, ends over here. Then what you have to do, you have to break that interval. See, your answer will be like this. So your answer will be 0 to 2 pi by 3, and then this value. Okay, this value is probably going to be 4 pi by 3. So from 4 pi by 3 to 2 pi, right? Right, so you have to take a union of those two answers. And then again, you will add 2n pi to the upper and the lower limits, and then take a union of the union itself, which is going to make it a little bit complicated. I'm not saying it is going to be wrong. Don't worry. Nobody's going to mark that wrong, but it is just going to make it look complicated. That's it. So Tejaswini, you can follow 0 to 2 pi also, but in that 0 to 2 pi itself, you have to take a union of two answers, right? Correct. And when you take a union of two answers and then again add a 2n pi and then again take a union, it will make it look complicated. But however, having said that, it all depends upon the option given to you. Okay. Many things depend on the options. Especially in this chapter, we basically act as per the option. Right? Does that answer your question, Tejaswini? Okay. All right, so let's take one or two more questions. We will not go into, you know, a lot of questions because, you know, this topic is very straightforward. Yeah. So here in this question, they have thankfully asked us only to find the answer between 0 to 2 pi. Okay. Let us also do one thing, not only between 0 to 2 pi, but also in general, we will find out the answer. So find out the general solution also for this, as well as the solution lying between 0 to 2 pi. Let's do both the parts, if at all we can. Is Anith there in the session? Anith here from which school? Yes. Any success? Anybody? Okay. So this question is basically a simple factorizable question. So you can just break this as minus minus 6 sine x minus 2 sine x plus 3 less than equal to 0. Take 2 sine x common. So it becomes 2 sine x minus 3. Take a minus 1 common. 2 sine x minus 3 less than equal to 0. Right? So this is as good as saying 2 sine x minus 1 times 2 sine x minus 3 less than equal to 0. Yes or no? Okay. Now remember, this fellow is always a negative fellow. Why? It will always be a negative fellow. Why 2 sine x minus 3 will always be negative? Can anybody tell me that? Anybody? Simple. Come on. Why 2 sine x? Right. Because sine x max value is 1. So 2 sine x minus 3 will always be a negative quantity, which means something into negative is negative. That means that something should be positive. Correct. In other words, you are trying to solve this inequality. Yes or no? And this is something which we already solved a little while ago. So your answer will be, first of all, in 0 to 2 pi, your answer will be just this. Okay. So if you're looking for a solution, okay, in your 0 to 2 pi interval, this will be your answer. Fine. And if you're looking for a general solution, you just have to add a 2n pi to both the upper and the lower limits. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Of course, we have to write a union here. Sorry about that. Okay. So it's a union of all these intervals. Okay. Any questions, any concerns? So we are going to now take up the last question on this topic. And post that, we are going to start with the conic section ellipse. Fine. So ready for the last question? All right. So let's move on to the last question for this topic, which is, let's say, this one. Solve this trigonometric inequation. Yes. Anybody with any success? All right, so let's look into this. So let us bring everything to the left-hand side. Okay, so I'll bring the tan square x to the left side. I'll bring 3 tan x to the left side, greater than 0, fine? I'm sure it is factorizable. You can just take a tan square x common from this, take a minus 3 common from this. Okay. So this is as good as saying tan square x minus 3 times tan x minus 1 is greater than 0. Okay, this further is factorizable, I believe. Tan x minus root 3, tan x plus root 3. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention. You can start using your wavy curve method to solve this inequality as well. Okay, so you can consider tan x to be like a y. Okay. So let tan x be, you know, y. So it is like solving, you can say, polynomial inequality. Okay, you're trying to solve a polynomial inequality. So you can use a wavy curve sine scheme for this as well. So let me just make the roots of these factors. So this is negative root 3, 1, root 3. Okay, so plus, minus, correct? So it is going to be positive only when y lies between negative root 3 to 1 or root 3 to infinity, right? But this is your y value. But y value is not what I need. I need the value of x, isn't it? So ask yourself if your tan x is between. So let me make the graph of tan x also for you. So we all know tan x graph is something like this. Correct? Okay. And let's say this is your value negative root 3. Negative root 3. And this is, let's say, positive root 3. And this is 1, let's say. Okay. Now ask yourself, if your tan x is between negative root 3 to 1, what is the interval of x in which it should happen? Let's say I analyze it between minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 only. So your x should lie between, all of you please pay attention, minus pi by 3 to pi by 4. Yes or no? And for 3 to infinity, it should lie between pi by 3 to pi by 2. Am I correct? Does this make sense? Yes or no? Correct. So what I'm going to do now, in this I'm going to add periodicity of tan x, which is pi, into n to all the upper and the lower limits that you see and take a union of that answer. So my answer would be, final answer would be, x belongs to union of n pi minus pi by 3 to n pi plus pi by 4. Again, there will be a small union coming up over here. In this case, we don't have any option, but we have to write two unions. As far as possible, try to avoid, but there is no other option left but to write in this case. Okay, union n pi plus pi by 2, where n is an integer. Is this fine? So why did I write n pi here? Why not 2n pi? Because we are dealing with tan x function, right? We are dealing with tan x function, and tan x function is periodic with a period of pi. Okay. Had we, you know, got sine x or cos x function or sec x cosec x function, we would have written 2n pi, not n pi. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns? So with this, we are going to close this particular chapter of trigonometric equations. And we are going to start with a new one today, which, as I already told you, is conic sections. Fine. So before I move on to the next slide, please ask any doubts, any questions, any concerns that you have with respect to this. So you'll receive a separate assignment sheet for this topic, okay, after today's session. Okay. All good? Great. So let's move on.